you said cocoon, and you kind of paint, I think in the book, I've read a lot of your articles too on the Scientific American, which are brilliant. So I'm kind of mixing things up in my head a little
bit.
But there's, what does that cocoon look like? What is a civilization that's able to harness the power of multiple suns, for example, look like? Like if, when you imagine possible civilizations that are a million years more advanced than us, what do you think that actually like looks like?
I think it's very different than we can imagine. By the way, I should start from the point that even biological life, you know, just without technology getting into the game, could look like something we have never seen before. Mm-hmm. Take, for example, the nearest star, which is Proxima Centauri. It's 4.25 light years away. So they will know about the results of the 2016 elections only next month in February. 2021.
Yes.
It's very far away. But if you think about it, you know, this star is a dwarf star, and it's much cooler than it's twice as cold as the sun. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it emits mostly infrared radiation. So if there are any creatures on the planet close to it that is habitable, mm-hmm. which is called Proxima B. There is a planet in the habitable zone, in the zone just at the right distance where, in principle, liquid water can be on the surface. Mm-hmm. If there are any animals there, they have infrared eyes because our eyes was designed to be sensitive to where most of the sunlight is in the visible range. But Proxima Centauri emits mostly infrared. So,
you know, the nearest to see each other
in the nearest star system, these animals would be quite strange. They would have eyes that are detectors of infrared, very yeah. different from ours. Moreover, this planet Proxima B faces the star always with the same side, mm-hmm. so it has a permanent day side and a permanent night side. And obviously, the creatures that would evolve on the permanent day side, which is much warmer, would be quite different than those on the permanent night side. Between them, there would be a permanent sunset strip. And my daughters said that that's the best opportunity for high value real estate because you will see the sunset throughout your life, right?
Yeah.
The sun never sets on this strip.
Yeah.
So, you know, these worlds are out of our imagination. So
just even the individual creatures, the sensor suite that they're operating with might be very different.
Very different. So I think when we see something like that, we would be shocked. Not to speak about seeing technology. Now, so I don't even dare to imagine, you know. And I think, you know, obviously we can bury our head in the sand and say, it's never aliens, like yeah. many of my colleagues say. Yes. And it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you never look, you will never find. If you are not ready to find wonderful things, you will never discover them. And the other thing I would like to say is reality doesn't care whether you ignore it or not. You can ignore reality, but it's still there.
Yes.
So we can all agree, based on Twitter, that aliens don't exist. That Oumuamua was a rock.
Yeah.
We can all agree. And you will get a lot of likes.
Yes.
You'll have a big crowd of supporters. And everyone will be happy and give each other awards and honors and so
yes.
forth. But Oumuamua might still be an alien artifact. Who cares what humans agree on?
Yeah, exactly.
There is a reality out there. And we have to be modest enough to recognize that we should make our statements based on evidence. Science is not about ourselves. It's not about glorifying our image. It's not about getting honors, prizes, you know. A lot of the academic activity is geared towards creating your echo chamber where you have students, postdocs repeating your mantras so that your voice is heard loudly so that you can get more honors, prizes, recognition. That's not the purpose of science. The purpose is to figure out what nature is, right? And in the process of doing that, it's a learning experience.
Mm-hmm.
You make mistakes. You know, Einstein made 3 mistakes at the end of his career. He argued that in the 1930s, he argued that black holes don't exist, gravitational waves don't exist, and quantum mechanics doesn't have spooky action at a distance.
Yes.
And all 3 turned out to be wrong, Okay, so the point is that if you work at the frontier, of, then you make mistakes. It's inevitable because you can't tell what is true or not. And avoiding making mistakes in order to preserve your image makes you extremely boring. Okay, you will get a prize, but you will be a boring scientist because you will keep repeating things we already know. If you want to make progress, if you want to innovate, you have to take risks and you have to look at the evidence. It's a dialogue with nature. You don't know the truth in advance. You let nature tell you, educate you, and then you realize that what you thought before is incorrect. And a lot of my colleagues prefer to be in a state where they have a monologue. You know, if you look at these people that work on string theory,
yes,
they have a monologue. They know what, and in fact, their monologue is centered on anti-de Sitter space, which we don't live in.
Yeah.
Now, you know, it's, to me, it's just like the Olympics. You know, you define 100 meters and you say, whoever runs this 100 meters is the best athlete, the fastest, you know. And it's completely arbitrary. You could have decided it would be 50 meters or 20 meters. Okay. Who cares? You just measure the ability of people this way. So you define anti-de Sitter space as a space where you do your mathematical gymnastics. Mm-hmm. And then you find who can do it the best. And you give jobs based on that. You give prizes based. But as we said before, you know, nature doesn't care about, you know, the prizes that you give to each other. It cares, you know, it has its own reality and we should figure it out. And it's not about us. The scientific activity is about figuring out nature. And sometimes we may be wrong. Our image will not be preserved. But that's the fun, you know. Kids explore the world out of curiosity. And I always want to maintain my childhood curiosity. And I don't care about the labels that I have. In fact, having tenure is exactly the opportunity to behave like a child because you can make mistakes. And I was asked by the Harvard Gazette, you know, the Pravda of Harvard, what is the one thing that you would like to change about the world?
Yes.
And I said, I would like my colleagues to behave more like kids.
Yeah.
That's the one thing I would like them to do, because something bad happens to these kids when they become tenured professors. They start to worry about their ego and about themselves more than about the purpose of science, which is, you know, curiosity driven, figuring out from evidence. Evidence is the key. So when an object shows anomalies like Oumuamua, what's the problem discussing, you know, whether it's artificial or not? You know, so there was, I should tell you, there was a mainstream paper in Nature published saying it must be natural. That's it. It's unusual, but it must be natural, period. And then at the same time, some other mainstream scientists tried to explain the properties.
Yes.
And they came up with interpretations like it's a dust bunny, you know, the kind that you find in a household, a collection of dust particles pushed by sunlight, something we have never seen before. Or it's a hydrogen iceberg. It actually evaporates like a comet, but hydrogen is transparent. You don't see it. And that's why we don't see the cometary tail. Again, we have never seen something like that. In both cases, the objects would not survive the long journey.
Yes.
We discussed it in a paper that I wrote afterwards. But my point is, those that tried to explain the unusual properties went into great length at discussing things that we have never seen before, okay? Mm-hmm. So even when you think about a natural origin, you have to come up with scenarios that of things that were never seen before. Mm-hmm. And by the way, they look less plausible to me personally. But my point is, if we discuss things that were never seen before, right? Why not contemplate an artificial origin? What's the problem? Why do people have this pushback? You know, I worked on dark matter, and we don't know what most of the matter in the universe is.
Yeah.
It's called dark matter. It's just an acronym because we have no clue. We simply don't know. So it could be all kinds of particles. And over the years, people suggested weakly interacting massive particles, axions, all kinds of particles. And experiments were made. They cost hundreds of millions of dollars. They put upper limits, constraints that ruled out many of the possibilities that were proposed as natural initially. Yes. The mainstream community regarded it as a mainstream activity to search the nature of the dark matter. And nobody complained that it's speculative to consider weakly interacting massive particles. Now, I ask you, why is it speculative to consider extraterrestrial technologies? We have a proof that it exists here on Earth.
Yes.
We also know that the conditions of Earth are reproduced in billions of systems throughout the Milky Way galaxy. So what's more conservative than to say, if you arrange for similar conditions, you get the same outcome? How can you imagine this to be speculative? It's not speculative at all.
Yeah.
And nevertheless, it's regarded the periphery. And at the same time, you have physicists, theoretical physicists, working on extra dimensions, supersymmetry, super string theory,
yes,
the multiverse, maybe we live in a simulation. Yeah. All of these ideas that have no grounding in reality, some of which sound to me like, you know, just like what someone would say.
Science fiction, basically.
Because you have no way to test it, you know, through experiments. And experiments really are key. It's not just a nuance. You say, okay, forget about experiments, as some philosophers try to say. You know, if there is a consensus, what's the problem? The point is, it's key. Then that's what Galileo found.
Yes.
It's key to have feedback from reality.
Yes.
You know, you can think that you have $1 billion or that you are more rich than, you know, Elon Musk. That's fine. You can feel very happy about it. You can talk about it with your friends and all of you will be happy and think about what you can do with the money. Then you go to an ATM machine and you make an experiment. You, yes, check how much money you have in your checking account. And if it turns out that, you know, you don't have much, you can't materialize your dreams. Okay,
yes.
So you realize you have a reality check.
Yes.
And my point is, without experiments giving you a reality check, without the ATM machine showing you whether your ideas are bankrupt or not, without putting skin in the game, and by skin in the game, I mean, don't just talk about theoretical ideas, make them testable. If you don't make them testable, they're worthless. They're just like theology that is not testable. By the way, theology has some tests. Let me give you
that's interesting.
Three examples.
Yes.
It turns out that my book already inspired a PhD student at Harvard in the English department,
uh-huh,
to pursue a PhD in that direction. And she invited me to the PhD exam a couple of months ago. And in the exam, one of the examiners, a professor, asked her, "Do you know why Giordano Bruno was burnt at the stake?" And she said, "No, I think it's because he was an obnoxious guy and irritated a lot of people."
Yes.
Which is true. But the professor said, "No, it's because Giordano Bruno said that other stars are just like the sun, and they could have a planet like the Earth around them that could host life." And that was offensive to the church. Why was it offensive? Because there is the possibility that this life sinned. Okay? And if that life sinned on planets around other stars, it should have been saved by Christ. And then you need multiple copies of Christ. And that's unacceptable. How can you have duplicates of Christ?
Right.
And so they burned the guy.
So it was about... That's okay. I'm just like loading this all in because that's kind of brilliant. So he was actually already into, it's not just about the stars, it's anticipating that there could be other life forms.
Yeah.
Like, why, if there's other stars, why would it be special? Why would our star, yeah, be special?
He was making the right argument.
And he would just follow that all along to say, like, there should be other Earth-like places, there should be other life forms.
And then that was offensive.
To be copies of Christ.
Yeah, so that was offensive. So I said, yeah. I said to that professor, I said, "Great, you know, I wanted to introduce some scientific tone to the discussion."
Yes.
And I said, "This is great because now you basically laid the foundation for an experimental test of this theology."
Yeah.
What is the test? We now know that other stars are like the sun. And we know they have planets like the Earth around them. So suppose we find life there and we figure out that they sinned. Then we ask them, "Did you witness Christ?"
Mm-hmm.
And if they say no, it means that this theology is ruled out. So there is an experimental test. So this is experimental test number one. Another experimental test, you know, in the Bible, you know, in the Old Testament, Abraham heard the voice of God to sacrifice his son, right? Only son. And that's what the story says. Now, suppose Abraham, my name, by the way, had a voice memo up on his cell phone.
Yes.
He could have pressed this up and recorded the voice of God.
Yeah.
And that would have been experimental evidence that God exists, mm-hmm. right? Fortunately, he didn't. But it's an experimental test, mm-hmm. right? There is a third example I should tell, and that is Elie Wiesel attributed this story to Martin Buber, but it's not clear whether it's true or not. At any event, the story goes that Martin Buber, you know, he was a philosopher, and he said, you know, the Christians argue that Jesus, you know, the Messiah arrived already and will come back again in the future. The Jews argue that the Messiah never came and will arrive in the future. So he said, why argue? Both sides agree that the Messiah will arrive in the future. When the Messiah arrives, we can ask whether he or she came before, you know, like visited us, and then figure it out. And one side, so again, experimental test of a theology.
Yes.
So even theology, if it puts a skin in the game, you know, if it makes a prediction, could be tested, right? So why can't string theorists test themselves? Or why can't, you know, even cosmic inflation, that's another model that, you know, one of the inventors from MIT, Alan Guth, argues that it's not falsifiable. My point is, a theory that cannot be falsified is not helpful because it means that you can't make progress. You cannot improve your understanding of nature. The only way for us to learn about nature is by making hypotheses that are testable, doing the experiments and learning whether we are correct or not.
So and coupled that with a curiosity and open-mindedness that allows us to explore all kinds of possible hypotheses, but always the pursuit of those, the scientific rigor around those hypotheses is ultimately get evidence.
Knowledge is of what nature is should be a dialogue with nature.
Yes.
Rather than a monologue.
Monologue, beautifully put.